This is Christopher Cernike, hosting episode 12 of season 3 of the Current Topics in Science podcast. This podcast will address breaking scientific news in light of the origins debate and host interviews with scientists. This podcast is available on the following platforms: iTunes, Stitcher, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and iHeartRadio. Video recordings of the podcast will be uploaded to YouTube. Enjoy the podcast. Today on Current Topics in Science, we have the honor of hosting Jim Gibson. Jim Gibson has a Bachelor of Science degree in secondary education with our Biology Composite Science and a Master of Education degree in School Administration from Lamar University, and he's certified to teach biology, chemistry, and physics. Jim has been an assistant principal at the high school and a principal at junior high. He's also had several other interesting professions. He was at one point a firefighter, a store manager at Walmart, and he's also served as a captain in the Marine Corps. Jim's passion, though, has always been the scriptures and science. So he's also the author of the book, An Appeal to Reason. An Appeal to Reason is a book that examines the evidence of origins in the evolution versus creation debate. This book covers complexity, the fossil record, dinosaurs, and various other topics related to origins. You can find out how you can get the book by visiting jimgibson.net. The book is available for purchase on amazon.com. Jim, he's married to his wife, Laura, whom he dedicated the book to. And now, without further ado, good evening, Jim Gibson. How was your day and how are you doing?
Well, good evening, Christopher. It's been a great day and I'm doing very good.
It's a pleasure to have you on, Jim. And now, since this is Current Topics in Science, we're going to quickly look at this week's current topic. Jim, Forbes put out an article called Meet the Hermit Crab Who is Using a Sea Anemone Instead of a Shell. The article was by Liz Allen, who commonly covers marine biology subjects for Forbes. Allen wrote, "Hermit crabs are best known for using snail shells to protect their fleshy, shellless bodies. But one group of hermit crabs uses a cozier type of protection, a sea anemone. These anemone-wearing hermit crabs are collectively known as blanket hermit crabs for the adorable way in which they snuggle in their anemone homes. Interestingly enough, this crab is not a brand new discovery. According to Allen, the first known blanket hermit crab discovery occurred aboard the HMS Challenger in 1874 during a four-year oceanographic expedition. The voyage collected two blanket hermit crabs while exploring in the Philippines, a male and a female of the same species." Jim, I found this article very fascinating, as I own hermit crabs. And so you can imagine, when I was reading your book, I was delighted to see that in the first chapter, you included a discussion on design and symbiosis that featured hermit crabs. On page 19 of your book, An Appeal to Reason, you said, "The hermit crab, specifically the anemone hermit crab, has a very unique and intriguing relationship with the anemone." Jim, what do you think of this article, and how do hermit crabs reveal design and symbiosis?
Well, first of all, it was a very interesting article. I enjoyed it very much. Nature is always fascinating. I'd like to say, first of all, that although I do have a science background, I am definitely not an expert, but I believe that one does not have to be an expert to be able to examine the evidence. Fortunately, God has given us common sense and the ability to reason. It is from this premise that I answer questions when somebody asks me about creationism or evolution. It's always from a common sense approach and the God-given wisdom that he gave me. In the article that you mentioned, one thing that I noticed, it said that it had evolved specialized anatomy to hold and stretch the anemone as needed. The problem is, this is an assumption based on evolution. Is it found in the fossil record? Do we have proof that this special anatomy evolved? No, we don't. It is a created design. Although that some parts of the crab were soft-bodied, there's still plenty of evidence, fossil evidence for it. We even find fossil evidence of jellyfish. from my perspective, when I look at this, when I consider the hermit crab, whether shelled or blanket hermit crabs, to me, it screams design and symbiosis. When I think about the hermit crab and how it evolved, let's just go back in our time machine and consider that first hermit crab. It is completely defenseless. It has no protection, but in the article, it went to a sea anemone. How did it happen to know that this particular sea anemone would not eat it? Some sea anemones do eat crabs, hermit crabs. It's much easier for me to believe that a creator designed the little wonderful hermit crab to live in an environment that would best suit them. On that sixth day of creation, God stepped back and said, "It is very good." To me, the hermit crab is an excellent example of that very good creation. Thank you for the question, Christopher.
You're welcome. And so, Jim, from what I'm gathering, it sounds like you're saying that there is an intelligence behind not just the hermit crab, but behind the universe. That's that mind of the living God, Christ Jesus. That reminds me, on page 17 of your book, Appeal to Reason, you said, "The magnitude of the complexity found in living organisms demands that such complexity must have originated from an intelligence." On page 18, you continued this thought, stating, "If one sees design throughout the natural world, then it stands to reason that there was intelligence behind such design." However, Jim, someone who is more skeptical of that position, they might feel that you're making what they're going to call a God of the Gaps argument, which, according to encyclopedia.com, is the phrase God of the Gaps. It refers to the attempts to use statements about divine intervention in the physical world to fill in the gaps in scientific explanation. So, Jim, is the intelligent design argument an example of the God of the Gaps fallacy?
I don't think so at all. First of all, let's go back and consider how I hear that argument all the time, or that accusation of by evolutionists that creationists routinely use God of the Gaps. But really, when you consider evolution, what do they have? What is their God? I'll tell you what it is. It's time. And they use time as their, quote, God in the Gaps all the time. Time is always the hero of the plot in evolution. Actually, when you boil it down, it boils down to two things. There are two worldviews, creationism and evolution. There is a God or there is no God. Faith, both of them are philosophies. Evolution is a philosophy. Faith is what's needed for both of them. Faith in the evolutionists has no hope in it. All they have is a cessation of life. There is no hope beyond life. I once read about Professor Harold Urey, a Nobel winner. He once said that we believe as an article of faith that life evolved from dead matter. He was a little bit more truthful, I believe. And he knows that it took something tremendous. Evolution didn't provide that. It was an article of faith. It was a step of faith that the evolutionist has to have. Going from abiogenesis to biogenesis is a gargantuan gap for the evolutionists. That's why Professor Urey called it an article of faith. To the creationists, this faith gives the promise of eternal life. To the evolutionists, faith cannot give any promise except the end of one's existence. How sad.
That's actually a very somber thought. You know, but so what I'm hearing you say is that both the evolutionary worldview, the creationary worldview, both of these things have an aspect of faith. And there is a valid or valid scientific points that you can get from, say, intelligent design and creation. It's not God of the Gaps. So the faith is there, but it's not a blind faith. That reminds me, in your book, Appeal to Reason, you said that the evolutionary theory is unable to account for new kinds of organisms. So from that statement, I'm gathering that you'd put it more so in the blind faith category. On page 87, you wrote, "According to the Darwinian paradigm, it was the gradual, minute changes in the DNA, mutations, that eventually gave rise to different morphologies of animals and plants. However, it has become abundantly clear that the DNA molecule does not code for the morphology of an organism. Yes, it codes for the synthesis of proteins and RNA molecules and performs a host of other functions, but it does not provide the plan for the form of an organism. Thus, it cannot account for new kinds of organisms. So, Jim, if the evolutionary theory cannot account for new kinds of organisms, does the intelligent design creation theory have an adequate explanation?
Yes, it does. First of all, let me go back and just talk about this creation of ours, first of all. The complexity and uniqueness of living organisms is simply mind-boggling. No amount of time given to natural processes could produce such a variety of life. In fact, millions of dollars have been spent, hundreds, perhaps thousands of scientists have tried, yet not one single living cell has ever been produced in any of the world's laboratories. If we can't even make one simple single-cell organism, how can chance processes blindly form that first exquisite living cell? No, the evidence demands that there must have been a creator. One such marvel of life is found in the seed of a giant redwood. It's curious to know that the seed of a giant redwood is really the size of a tomato seed, yet it can grow into a 4-million-pound tree, which exceeds 250 feet in height. That's just one example. When you consider the fact of the sexes, male and female, of all the thousands of species in the world, then we find out that each species is especially designed to accommodate its opposite mate. This is no evolutionary accident. Both of these examples illustrate the concept of information. Where did this information come from? It comes from an omniscient, omnipotent creator. That is the only plausible explanation for the miracle of life. The evolutionists would have us believe that the computer is a product of design, yet they would deny that that designer of the computer was created. Instead, they would have us believe that he is a person that's just a cosmic accident in nature. They can believe in the design of a cardboard box, but they can't believe that a creator designed this marvelous body of all the different organs and systems that we have in it. It's amazing how blind they are.
So, basically, the evolutionary theory isn't just improbable. You're saying that it's impossible. You know, that sort of brings my mind back to page 93 and 94 of Appeal to Reason, where you made the argument. You said, Sir Fred Hoyle, he's the professor of applied math and astronomy, he calculated that the probability of getting an average cell by naturalistic processes to be in the order of 10 to the 40,000th power. In probability studies, anything that exceeds 10 to the 50th power is no longer within the realm of probability, but has essentially entered the sphere of impossibility. You said, the faith of the evolutionist does not shrink when confronted with such odds. Instead, the evolutionist sincerely believes that given enough time, anything can become possible. But Jim, evolutionary scientists such as John Allen Paulos, he's an American professor of mathematics at Temple University, he would say that this argument is a misunderstanding of both mathematics and statistics. Professor Paulos, he has an article called What's Wrong with Creationist Probability? And in it, he says, this line of argument, however, is deeply flawed. Leaving aside the issue of independent events, which is too extensive to discuss here, I note that there's always a fantastically huge number of evolutionary paths that might be taken by an organism or a process over time. I also note that there is only one that will actually be taken. So, if after the fact we observe the particular evolutionary path actually taken, and then calculate the a priori probability of its being taken, we will get the minuscule probability that creationists mistakenly attach to the process as a whole. Misunderstanding this tiny probability, they reject outright the evolutionary process. So, Jim, what do you think of Professor Paulos's argument? Is the probability argument against the evolutionary theory flawed?
I don't think it is in the least bit. First of all, he is not just a creationist. that believe that probability is a strong argument against evolution. There are quite a few evolutionists that affirm that. They too believe that probability is a strong argument against evolution. Yet they still believe in evolution. Why? Because they accept it as an article of faith. When I think about his words, what I find deeply flawed is his assumption that there is a, using his words, fantastically huge number of evolutionary paths that might be taken by an organism. That's a big assumption. He's assuming that every single path leads to a functional organism. And we know through empirical science that that is not the case. He has no way of knowing this to be true. However, it is just a statement made on faith in the evolutionary process. Makes me think of another evolutionary activist. His name is Ian Musgrave. He once made calculations about how easy it was for life to have risen by naturalistic processes. But there was another scientist, Dr. Harold Marowitz. He was a professor of molecular biophysics and biochemistry at Yale University. He gave an astronomical number for life to have risen by chance processes. But Dr. Marowitz still believed in it. Why? Because it was an article of faith for him. It wasn't until many years later, he finally came to the realization and truth that their life must have arisen by some intelligent power. No, I totally disagree. Regardless of his credentials, probability is a strong argument against evolution.
Jim, thank you so much for going over the accuracy of the probability argument. So I think it would be interesting, though, if we changed gears from comparing and contrasting the explanatory power of both the design and the evolutionary theory, and let's take a look at the implications both ideas have for every single one of us, humans, that is. So with that being said, we're going to take a look at the ideas in Chapter 11 of your book, Appeal to Reason, called Human Evolution. You said, the layperson, when reading any science article on human origins, would think that human evolution has been proved and documented beyond any doubt. We've been taught that our ancestral lineage has been traced to a most acceptable degree. Should one waver in their thoughts with regard to human evolution, the evolutionist needs but to answer with only one word, Lucy. Evolutionists such as Ruth Shuster, who obtained her biology degree from Hebrew University, would indeed say that Lucy is a powerful piece of evidence for the evolutionary theory. Shuster published an article called Rosetta Stone Fossil Shows Australopithecus Signs Still Had Ape-like Shoulders. In her article, she said, the evidence is clear that this ancient human ancestor could and did walk 3.5 million years ago, but its shoulder and arm structures were still suited to the arboreal lifestyle. Her shoulder structure supported arms suited for hanging from branches, swinging from them, or shimmying up and down trees. Later hominins and we folk have a pectoral girdle more suited to just dangling by our sides or throwing rocks. The fossils provides the best evidence yet of how human ancestors use their arms halfway down our evolutionary path. So, Jim, is it true that Lucy shows that human ancestors had ape-like shoulders?
Well, I believe that the fossil that they found definitely did have ape-like shoulders. But to connect that to human evolution is a gigantic step. First of all, whenever time I read something about a missing human ancestor that they found, my antenna automatically go up. I guess because when I've read many, many articles and I've researched it, I found out, for instance, one such organism that they found that was a ancestor, allegedly. They found the, and they said it walked upright and everything. But what they found was fossils from as far as the feet, for instance, were found some several kilometers away. In fact, in different strata, but yet they put them all together in that one fossil find. Now, that makes me think their credibility is highly suspect. They can't help it. You know, they get paid for their research, and the research has demands that it must support evolution. When I think about this particular article, I think about, first of all, the idea that it was evidence that this Lucy walked upright. They only found 4 ankle bones. Again, when you put the skeleton together and you find that there's 4 ankle bones, the one bone that is truly missing, that they need to determine whether or not it walked upright, is the calcaneus bone, the heel bone. Again, it was how they put together the foot bones. So they naturally were predisposed to arrange the ankle bones to where they would provide for a larger ankle, the heel bones, to a large for a, I'm sorry. They naturally were predisposed to arrange the ankle bones to allow for a larger ankle bone or heel bone. Again, this is purely subjective, and it was based on their evolutionary persuasion. When I was doing my book, I found out that there had been, at that time, no chimpanzee fossils found. Not until 2005. However, they have found, just like Lucy, about 4 feet tall, they have found plenty of those fossil skeletons that had the same height of a chimpanzee. They had hands and feet like a chimpanzee. Their cranial features were much like a chimpanzee, yet they were unable to ever find the fossil of a chimpanzee. Not until 2005. All the rest of them were classified as a human ancestor. But at least they got the right classification, Southern ape. That is the true classification, and that's what they were. They were apes. They were not humans. They were not our ancestors. There are no ancestral apes to humans. Both were created on day 6 of the creation week.
Jim, so if Lucy's not evidence for human evolution, then the missing link for both human and ape evolution is still missing. On page 267 of Appeal to Reason, I think you had an interesting remark. You penned, "I think it is scientific wonder that paleontologists and anthropologists can discover man's ancestors, but found it difficult to locate the ancestors of the chimpanzees." A BBC article called, "We Have Still Not Found the Missing Link Between Us and Apes," seems to echo your remark in its title. The article communicates, "Our species has a long-lost parent. Evolutionary biologists call this species the last common ancestor, or LCA. Most people know it by a non-scientific name, the missing link. Scientists have been on the trail of the LCA for decades, and they still have not found it. But many are convinced that they have established enough information to make the hunt a lot easier. They think they know roughly when and where the LCA lived. They even have a reasonable idea of what it looked like and how it behaved. Strauss could not say exactly which species should be recognized as our sister, but the LCA could well have been a relatively small-bodied primate that ran along branches rather than swinging beneath them." Jim, does the evidence point to the idea that humans and apes are descended from this small-bodied primate running along the branches in the earth of yesteryear? Why or why not?
No, it does not. All the evidence is always interpreted in light of one's worldview. To the creationist, the so-called evidence just points to some form of extinct primate. In fact, many scientists believe that this last common ancestor, this missing link that we're looking for apes and humans, was none other than a little animal called Archosaurus. Many of them say this must be the first primate. What they have really done is just created an illusion of a foundation, because that's what they need, an illusion of a foundation for human ancestry. The fact is, none exists. When you look at the size of the Archosaurus, when you look at the weight, approximate weight, its morphology, its skeletal morphology itself, really it is not any different than the modern day mouse lemur or tarsier. Why can't they just accept the fact that this Archosaurus is just a ancestor of the today's mouse lemur or tarsier? They just have to do something. They've got to find a foundation, however false foundation it is, to assume human ancestry. Again, there is none.
Jim, thank you so much for explaining the true ancestor, human beings. When I was reading through your book, I was very fascinated by this telling comment. You quoted Donald Johansson as saying, "There is no such thing There's a total lack of bias. I have it. Everybody has it. You begin straining your eyes to find Homo traits in fossils of that age. Logical, maybe, but also biased. I was trying to jam evidence of dates into a pattern that would support conclusions about fossils which, on closer inspection, the fossils themselves would not sustain. So Jim, if the evolutionary theory cannot account for the dates of the fossils, do the alternatives fare any better? Can the biblical creation model account for the fossils without having to jam evidence of dates into a pattern that will fit the model?
Absolutely. I've thought of a evolutionist, a geologist who was an evolutionist. He said before he became a creationist, before he became a Christian, he never saw evidence of a worldwide flood. But after he became a Christian, he said, everywhere I looked, there was evidence of a worldwide flood. When I think about fossils, I live in Northwest Arkansas. Everywhere I walk in my yard, I pick up a rock, it's got a fossil in it. That phenomena is worldwide. Fossilization occurs when a plant or animal have been buried under water-laid sediment. We find billions of fossils all over the world. Yet it is a rare event, if at all it even happens, to see the processes of fossilization occurring today. I read once of a petroleum engineer who happened to work for an oil company that dug wells there in the Gulf of Mexico. He said he had dug hundreds, thousands of core samples, and he never once found an organism in the process of fossilization. It just didn't happen. It's amazing to me how evolutionists have no problem in accepting the fact of local floods in the ancient past as being the mechanism of fossilization, but they adamantly deny a single worldwide flood occurred. The reason for this is simple. It would completely demolish their entire evolutionary paradigm. The year-long Noachian flood can easily account for fossilization and the placement of these fossils. In this model, flood sediment was deposited based upon the rapidity of the currents, the density or specific gravity of the particles of sediment, the ecological habitats of the organic remains, daily tides acting upon the receding waters, and many other physical and tectonic pressures that were present during this period of Earth's upheaval. No, evolution can't answer that, but creationism, in light of the Noachian flood, answers all of these issues.
Jim, we've now arrived at our final question. One of the closing chapters of your book is called The Seeds of Evolution. You chronicle the evidence that indicates that the evolutionary theory provided the presuppositional framework for what you listed as communism, humanism, and atheism. Jim, I'm wondering, if these are the seeds of the evolutionary theory, what are the seeds of creation?
Well, first of all, when we talk about creation, we go back to Genesis, the book of beginnings, and talking about the seed, we plant the seed there that God is the creator of all things. But we also see in those first few chapters how that Satan came, and the first thing he did was to make Eve doubt God's word. Did God really say that? Did God really say that? When I look and I think about those first, we'll say decades possibly, of our creation, many cultures, I've read that many cultures call this period of mankind's early years as the golden age. It was a time of peace and tranquility, a time of bounty, a time of harmony between mankind and all the rest of God's creation. But as we know, this utopian existence was abruptly ended when man sinned. I'm so thankful that although we sinned, God had to pronounce judgment. But at the same time he was pronouncing judgment, he promised that he would one day redeem mankind from the curse of sin. God had to shed innocent blood to cover man's nakedness and his shame. But he did say that one day he would send a redeemer that would come and shed his blood to redeem man and allow him once again to have fellowship with his creator. I would like the listeners today to consider this. Do you believe in a theory that gives no hope beyond this life? Or will you instead look to God, your creator, so that he may give you eternal life in a place far more beautiful than this present world? Thank you, Christopher, for having me on your podcast today.
Jim, thank you very much for your time. It was an absolute joy. And to our listeners, thank you very much for taking the time to learn with us on Current Topics in Science, where scientific discoveries are examined in light of the origins issue. You can find Jim's biography and his other resources available at jimgibson.net. And if you go to amazon.com, you'll be able to purchase your copy of his book, An Appeal to Reason. Please share and subscribe to the Current Topics in Science podcast. It's available on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and iHeartRadio. Thanks again for listening, and remember, the truth saves.